Welcome to our physics lesson today. My name is Nicholas Okuthe. We want to continue from where we left yesterday. Yesterday, we briefly gave the description of the topic from the most important areas that is examined. So today, today's lesson, we want to look in details those areas that we talked about yesterday. This was just brief. So we want to go briefly or in details what this topic involves, the quantity of it. We started looking at some important terms, and that's what we are going to look at, like the differences between heat and temperature. We defined heat as a form of energy that flows from one body to another due to temperature difference, and it normally flows from a body of high temperature to a body of low temperature. So whenever bodies are at the same temperature, there will be no net movement of heat. So heat only moves when one body is at a high temperature, another is at a low temperature. We also looked at differences between heat and temperature. One is from the definition, heat being a form of energy, temperature being the degree of hotness or coldness of a body. Now, we learned that heat is measured in joules. The SI unit is joules. Temperature, the SI unit is Kelvin. Then another difference that is not here is that heat cannot be measured directly using an instrument, but it will be calculated, and that's what this topic involves. We'll be calculating quantity of heat using various formulas that we learned yesterday. But temperature can be measured directly using an instrument called thermometer. So we want to start with the first term that we looked at yesterday called heat capacity, whose symbol is capital C. Remember, heat capacity is capital C, specific heat capacity is small c. Note the difference. So heat capacity is the quantity of heat required, or quantity of heat required to raise the temperature of a given mass of a substance by 1 Kelvin. The key word here is given mass. Quantity of heat required to raise the temperature of a given mass of a substance, be it water, be it any liquid or any substance that is heated or cooled. Whenever there is a change in temperature by 1 Kelvin, then the heat is absorbed or given out is what we call heat capacity. And heat capacity is calculated using C is the quantity of heat divided by the change in temperature, or simply Q is equal to C delta theta. So in that case, we don't need the mass, and SI unit becomes joule per Kelvin. Remember from the formula C is equal to Q over C, Q is in joules, delta theta is in Kelvin. So the unit becomes joules divided by Kelvin, which is joule per Kelvin. Now, different substances have different rates of heat absorption, therefore different heat capacity. For example, the amount of heat required maybe to raise the temperature of water by 1 Kelvin is different from the amount of heat that you will require to raise the temperature of paraffin by 1 Kelvin. So they have different heat capacities. Then, look at this example. Calculate the quantity of heat required to raise the temperature of a metal block with a heat capacity of 600 joules per Kelvin from 20 to 60. So we are given heat capacity and we are given the temperature, the initial temperature and the final temperature. So with that, we are able to get the change in temperature and use that to calculate the quantity of heat. So using the formula Q is equal to C delta theta, C is 600 joules per Kelvin, which is the heat capacity. Delta theta is the change in temperature. So we take the higher temperature minus the lower temperature, 600 minus 60 minus 20, which gives us 40. So 40 multiplied by 24 by 600, you get 24,000 joules as the quantity of heat required. You can also have this exercise. An electrical heater rated 240 V, 3 amperes, raises the temperature of a liquid X from 25 to 55 in 10 minutes. Calculate the heat capacity of the liquid. So we are able to use this to calculate the amount of heat given out by the heater, because we have the voltage, we have the current, and we have the time. So heat given out by the heater is VIT. Then that quantity of heat, you equate it to C delta theta so that you get the heat capacity of the liquid. Then the next term that is also similar or almost similar to heat capacity is specific heat capacity. So we've just added the word specific. And because I said the key word is in heat capacity is given mass, in specific heat capacity, the keyword here is now unit mass. The rest of the terms remain. The only word that has changed is unit. Heat capacity we use given mass, but specific heat capacity, we use unit mass. Sometimes if you don't want to use the unit mass, you can use 1 kilogram mass. So the word unit can be replaced by 1 kg mass of a substance. So the quantity of heat required to raise the temperature of a given, of a unit mass of a substance by 1 Kelvin is what we refer to as specific heat capacity. And the symbol there now is small c. Now, from that definition, we get specific heat capacity as the heat energy absorbed, that is Q, over mass times the temperature change. And if you simplify that and make Q the subject, then you get the quantity of heat Q is equal to mc delta theta. And that's what we learned as the other, the second formula for calculating heat capacity of a substance. So the SI unit from this formula, Q is in joules, mass in Kelvin, in kilogram, and change temperature in Kelvin, you get the unit to be joules per kilogram per Kelvin, written in that manner. Now, we can have the relationship between specific heat capacity and heat capacity being this. Specific heat capacity is the can be also be given by heat capacity divided by mass. When you have heat capacity divided by mass, you'll get specific heat capacity. Also, if heat capacity is specific heat capacity times mass. Note this, if two substances have the same masses or same mass and are subjected to the same amount of heat, then they will require different temperature changes because they have different specific heat capacities. For example, specific heat capacity of iron is 460 joules per kilogram. That means that 1 kilogram of iron will take or give out 460 joules of heat when its temperature changes by 1 Kelvin. So whenever you heat 1 kg of iron, then it will absorb 460 joules of heat when the temperature rises by 1 Kelvin. Similarly, when you cool it, it will give out the same amount of heat when the temperature drops by 1 Kelvin. Look at an example here. A block of copper of mass 10 kg and specific heat capacity 460 joules per kilogram per Kelvin cools from 80 degrees Celsius to 40 degrees Celsius. Find the quantity of heat given out. So we have the mass, we have the specific heat capacity, and we can get the temperature change. So if you want the quantity of heat, then just say quantity of heat is equal to Q is equal to mc delta theta. Mass m is 10 kg. C, specific heat capacity is 460. Change in temperature is 80 minus 40. Remember, I said you take the higher temperature minus the lower temperature. It's not about final minus initial, but is the change. The change can be the bigger one minus the smaller one, or the smaller minus the bigger one. But because temperature is a scalar quantity, we normally take the higher value or higher temperature minus the lower temperature. So we get 184,000 joules. Which can also be written as 184 kilojoules. 1 kilojoules is the same as 1,000 joules. We can also, or you can have this exercise. A block of metal of mass 1.5, which is suitably insulated, is heated from 30 to 50 in 8 minutes and 20 seconds by an electric coil, rated 54 watts. Find the quantity of heat supplied by the heater. So you know the heater is electrical method, so we use VIT. Or if we don't have V and I, like we have here, we are given P, the power, in as 54 watts. So you take power, you multiply time, and you ensure that the time is converted to seconds. Then heat capacity of the metal block, then specific heat capacity of the block. When you have heat capacity, to get specific heat capacity, you simply multiply specific heat capacity divided by mass, you get specific heat capacity. The second question is also there, find the final temperature of water. If a heater rated 50 watts heats 100 grams of water from 25 in 5 minutes, you are given specific capacity for what? 4,200 joules per kilogram per Kelvin. Now, we will look at methods of determining specific heat capacity of substances. There are two methods. One is mixtures method and another one is electrical method. Mixtures method involves having a substance, for example, a solid metal block, heated maybe in some container like a calorimeter or water in a calorimeter, then you record various measurements like mass of the metal block, you record the initial temperature of water, the final temperature of water, yeah. Then when you transfer it to maybe a colder substance, or sorry, a colder liquid, maybe at room temperature, you factor in the, you record the new changes, like the new temperature, if at all this change in mass, which normally doesn't occur. The only thing that majorly changes is the temperature. So in this case, you realize that a hot substance is mixed with a relatively cold substance. Then heat energy is transferred from hot body to a cold body until the thermal equilibrium is established. So you equate now heat lost by the hotter substance to the heat gained by the colder substance. Then from there you are able to calculate a specific heat capacity of the substance using various formulas. And in this case, we normally use a calorimeter, water, maybe at higher temperature being in a calorimeter, or at room temperature being in a calorimeter. Calorimeter is normally designed in such a way that it minimizes heat loss to the surrounding. In the mixtures method, there are specific precautions that we need to take into consideration to minimize heat loss, because in this method of mixtures, a major precaution is that there is normally no or negligible heat loss to the surrounding. So to minimize heat losses, one thing we need to do is to ensure that the calorimeter is highly polished. A polished surface is a poor absorber and poor emitter. So it means it minimizes heat loss to the surrounding. Then the calorimeter should be heavily lugged. Heavily lugged means there is some insulator placed around it to minimize heat loss through conduction. Then the calorimeter should be closed using an insulating lid. That is a lid made of a poor conductor to minimize heat loss through evaporation or the method of convection, sorry. Yeah. So with that, we'll be able to look at an example of how that is. Look at this example. A metal block of mass 0.15 at 100 degrees Celsius was transferred to a copper calorimeter of mass 0.4 containing a liquid of mass 0.8 at 20 degrees Celsius. The block and the calorimeter and its content eventually reached a common temperature. Given that specific capacity of aluminium is 900 and that of copper is 400, calculate specific capacity of the liquid. So in that case, we equate heat loss by the metal block. The metal block at higher temperature, 100 degrees Celsius, is equal to heat gained by the calorimeter and the liquid. So the heat loss by the metal block is MC delta theta, and we are using subscript B. Heat loss by the liquid is MC delta theta, we are using subscript L to denote that. And heat loss by the calorimeter is also MC delta theta, we are using the small c to denote the calorimeter. So you equate the information given there, then you work out the value of CL. And when you work it out, you get 306.25. Thank you. That is the end of our lesson.